Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
Consumer Cellular understands that not everyone needs an unlimited wireless plan. Our U.S.-based customer service reps can help you choose a plan based on how much you use your phone. Nothing more, nothing less. To learn more, go to consumercellular.tv.
Financial services firm, Raymond James. Leidos. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
For many Americans, today is a day of solemn remembrance for those killed in military service. President Trump paid tribute during a Memorial Day service at Arlington National Cemetery outside Washington. He laid a wreath at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier and thanked the families who've lost loved ones in service to their country.
The heroes who rest in these hallowed fields, in cemeteries, battlefields, and burial grounds near and far, are drawn from the full tapestry of American life. They came from every generation, from privilege and from poverty. They were generals and privates, captains and corporals of every race, color, and of every creed.
Several former military leaders criticized President Trump today for tweeting that fallen troops would have been, quote, very proud of how the country is doing under his administration. Retired Army General Martin Dempsey, a former chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, responded, quote, this day of all days of the year should not be about any one of us. New efforts are underway to put a U.S.-North Korean summit back on track. Officials from both sides met Sunday along the border between the Koreas. Another U.S. team headed to Singapore, the potential summit site. Meanwhile, South Korean President Moon Jae-in says he may meet again with North Korea's Kim Jong-un after holding talks on Saturday. We'll have more after the news summary. The Florida Panhandle is bracing for flash flooding and possible tornadoes from the storm named Alberto. It made landfall this evening near Panama City with heavy rain and sustained winds of 50 miles an hour. The storm emptied beaches in much of the state as high winds swept up the surf. It's expected to move north in the coming days. A powerful storm hit Oman and Yemen this weekend, leaving 13 people dead in its wake. It was the strongest recorded cyclone ever to hit the area, with winds of 110 miles an hour and flooding that swept people away in their cars. Oman got three times its annual rainfall in just 2 days. The people of Colombia now face a presidential runoff, with the future of a peace deal with rebels in the balance. Conservative Iván Duque easily led Sunday's first round, with leftist Gustavo Petro in second. Duque ran on overhauling the 2016 deal that ended 5 decades of war with the FARC rebels. Petro, a former mayor of Bogotá, supports the deal.
We are ready for a clash of ideas and proposals, a high-level debate where we can air our differences so that Colombians at the ballot box define the country's direction, because I'm sure that hope will overcome class hatred.
The sort of political forces that are surrounding Duque appear to have a ceiling. In contrast, we, the forces of free citizens, have no limits. You can be sure we are going to win and change the history of Colombia.
The runoff is set for June 17th. Former President George H.W. Bush is back in the hospital, this time in Maine. The 93-year-old was admitted Sunday with low blood pressure and fatigue. He'd been staying at his summer home in Kennebunkport. Mr. Bush spent 13 days in a Houston hospital after his wife, Barbara, died in April. And an immigrant from Mali has won French citizenship for saving a child in Paris. Mamadou Gassama met today with President Emmanuel Macron. Amateur video on Saturday showed Gassama climbing four stories to reach a four-year-old boy who was clinging to a balcony. Gassama recounted his actions today.
No, I didn't think twice. I just climbed up and thank God. God helped me. The more I climbed, the more I had courage to climb up higher. That's it.
The video of Gassama's heroism went viral on social media, and he was quickly dubbed Spider-Man. Still to come on the News Hour, will the U.S. and North Korea be successful in reviving plans for a summit? Political stakes. The president blames Democrats for immigrant children being separated from their parents. Honoring the millions of women who have served in the United States military, and much more. Over the weekend, the pace of diplomacy with North Korea has picked up in an effort to revive the summit between President Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. Foreign Affairs correspondent Nick Schifrin reports.
Amna, thank you. Two U.S. teams are trying to resurrect the summit. One is in Singapore working on logistics. The second met with North Korean officials in North Korea. That team is led by veteran diplomat Sung Kim, currently the U.S. ambassador to the Philippines, and also includes Assistant Secretary of Defense Randall Shriver and Allison Hooker from the National Security Council staff. These meetings come after another extraordinary show of friendship between North Korean leader Kim Jong-un and South Korean President Moon Jae-in. They met this weekend on 24 hours' notice, their second summit in just the last month. President Moon is the man in the middle, pushing both sides toward the summit. And to talk about all this, I'm joined by Patrick McGeckren, a State Department official focused on East Asia, who's currently on leave at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. Thank you very much for being here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Last week, a senior White House official said that June 12th is, I'm quoting him here, like in 10 minutes, suggesting that it was impossible to get the logistics ready by June 12th. Is it impossible at this point to get those logistics ready?
I don't think so. Look, in your intro, you noted how the North Koreans and the South Koreans were able to set up a summit and execute it within 24 hours. It might take the United States a little bit longer to execute these sorts of things, but I don't think it's unrealistic that we should be able to get it done by June 12th. The real challenge, I think, won't be so much the logistics, but the policy preparations that are going on right now.
Right. So the policy preparations are happening, presumably, as far as we know, in North Korea, in these conversations that are ongoing. Do those teams that are meeting, do they have to agree on an agenda? Do they have to agree on a document that the president, Trump, and Kim Jong-un would sign together? Or is it even less than that?
I think they need to agree on some sort of an agenda. What are the two leaders going to try to accomplish when they meet in Singapore or wherever they might decide to meet in the end? This isn't really an effort to try to tee up some sort of a peace treaty or a detailed roadmap, I think, to denuclearization. I think a successful summit would mean having a general roadmap of the way forward for denuclearization and what sort of reciprocal concessions the United States would have to make. And I think that's what our team in North Korea is trying to hammer out right now.
So that's what a lot of experts seem to want, to slightly lower the expectations. But President Trump has not lowered expectations. They've been quite high. At one point, he was saying that this summit could create peace, regional peace, and stability. So do you think the expectations need to be lowered?
Well, I think it's appropriate for both sides and natural that the two sides go into a negotiation looking to have their maximum demands possible. And then they narrow differences from there. So I think that's where President Trump is coming from in trying to say, you know, he wants to see denuclearization right away, but that doesn't mean that that's the only thing that he's willing to accept.
So there is a divide on denuclearization, how quickly that may happen. We may see that play out in the summit. The other main variable that we're going to see, of course, is the level of security guarantees that North Korea asks for and that the U.S. is willing to give. We heard President Moon over the weekend say the North Koreans have real concerns about those security guarantees. So what kind of security guarantees does the North want to hear from the U.S. In order to reciprocate with quick denuclearization?
Well, the two sides will each define their own demands. And so for the United States, we get to define what we mean by denuclearization, because that is our demand of the North Koreans. By contrast, the North Koreans get to define what they want in terms of security guarantees. And we try to find where there's a match between the two. And while there's been a great deal of speculation as to what the North Koreans are going to request with respect to security guarantees or economic pressure relief, the fact remains is that Kim Jong-un has not articulated that to us yet. And so we really just don't know exactly what they're going to be looking for.
We saw these images, extraordinary, just to think that we've had two summits between President Moon Jae-in of South Korea and Kim Jong-un of North Korea. Does their relationship, does that help push along the summit? But could it also threaten the alliance between the United States and South Korea?
I think it absolutely pushes along the USDPRK summit. I think Moon Jae-in has really done an extraordinary job of trying to bring the United States and North Korea together. But at the same time, he very firmly recognizes that his treaty ally is the United States, and that the reason why he's meeting with the North Koreans is because they are South Korea's enemy. They are the ones that are pointing 8,000 artillery tubes at the South Korean capital. So Moon Jae-in is not really caught between North Korea and the United States. He's really firmly on the American side, but trying to broker a constructive peace forward.
But some people are concerned that there could be a divide between what South Korea has the priority, for example, of ending the Korean War for once and for all, and the U.S. priority of denuclearization.
So it's always natural that that allies are not going to see things 100% the same way. But the United States and South Korea have very tightly aligned interests and values, and I think that will overwhelm the differences. And the United States and South Korea have met a great deal. You've known that the president was just here in Washington, their national security advisor, their foreign minister, have all visited Washington very recently in order to make sure that there's no daylight between Seoul and Washington moving forward.
Okay. Patrick McEachran, thank you very much.
Thank you.
North Korea remains a focus of Washington politics, but there's also growing attention on immigration and immigration enforcement. And that is where we'll begin this Politics Monday, with Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report, Susan Page of USA Today, and from Santa Ana, California, Cindy Carcamo, a reporter who covers immigration for the Los Angeles Times. Amy and Susan, thanks for being here. We want to get to a little bit of breaking news we've had just as we've come on the air. We've just learned Representative Thomas Garrett, a Republican from Virginia, has announced that he's struggling with alcoholism and he's not going to seek re-election. So, Amy, give me a sense of what this means, what we know about his district, how it changes the landscape ahead.
Yeah, this is a district outside of Charlottesville. Garrett was one of the members of the Freedom Caucus, and only recently there was a report, I think it was in Politico, that outlined the challenges that many of his staffers were having. This was a very demanding boss, asking them to do things that were completely inappropriate, including at one point cleaning up. This was in the story, the dog would come into the office and have some problems that would need to be taken care of. But he announced in something of a rambling press conference last week that he was going to come back for sure and run for re-election. Mm-hmm. The news today is then not that surprising, given all of the stories that have come out since that press conference. The question is whether or not Democrats can make this a real race. Part of the reason this race was competitive was that Garrett himself had a number of controversies, and he was not a particularly strong fundraiser. Mm-hmm. But it also points to the fact that Republicans now, this would be something like their 30th something. I can't remember the number total of retirements on the part of Republicans, which is the highest number we have seen. You have to go back to the 30s of retirements from Republicans. Anytime there's an open seat, it is much harder for the party to hold on to it. You want to have an incumbent there.
How hard, Amy, is that?
I just looked up that number. 44th House Republican choosing not to run again. Some of them are running for other offices, some of them are retiring.
That's a remarkable number.
And it's a sign that we aren't sure how good a year this is going to be for Democrats.
Yeah.
But Republicans who are serving in the House have decided it's going to be a very good year for Democrats running against them. Even in this district, Trump carried this district by 11 percentage points last time around. So it's a Republican district, but it is not so overwhelmingly Republican that you couldn't imagine in a good Democratic year, Democrats winning it.
So let's look ahead a little bit now. We're in a bit of a bye week when it comes to primaries. I know we often talk about what we learn from the primaries we're keeping an eye on. Look back for me, Susan. What have we learned in terms of trends moving forward? How does that inform the 8 states that will have primaries next week?
You know, one thing that has struck me is kind of the nature of the two parties. The Republican Party that we've seen in these primaries is Trump's party. This is Trump's Republican Party. You see almost no Republican candidates who are running for office this fall criticizing the president. Some talk about him more than others. Some embrace him more closely than others. But there is almost no criticism of Trump among Republicans who are running for office. And in the Democratic Party, this is Bernie Sanders' Democratic Party. Not for Bernie Sanders in particular, but Bernie Sanders in his more progressive stance has really taken hold. Bernie Sanders' candidates, the candidates endorsed by Our Revolution, his group, the group affiliated with him, have not done so well in contested elections. But the whole party has moved to the left. And you look, thinking about the election, the primaries coming up next week, the big one in California, Dianne Feinstein, 5th term, she has clearly moved to the left in response to the energy in the party being on the progressive side, including now in, saying she opposes the death penalty. That's quite at odds with the position she's taken in the past.
Amy, what are you watching next week?
Yeah, there's another theme in addition to the ones that Susan mentioned, which is women, and especially Democratic women. So my colleague David Wasserman looked at all the primaries that have taken place thus far. We're about a third of the way through primary season. There were 65 races on the Democratic side that featured at least one woman and one man and no incumbent, and women won 70% of those. There is not a similar trend going on the Republican side. They've only won Republican women who are not incumbents have only won about 20% of their primaries. California, which is coming up on June 5th, lots of women running, close to 30 women on the ballot. Obviously, they're not going to all win, but that's going to be very important. And the most important thing about to watch for California is this thing called the top two primary. Mm-hmm. This is a new law that was put in place after 2010 in order to make the primary more open, encourage more people to come and vote, and theoretically, even in a very conservative or very liberal district, give voters a chance to get maybe a more moderate member of that reigning party. In this case, the challenge for Democrats is because they have so many candidates, the top two vote getters, and that's how this process works, the top two vote getters, regardless of party, go on to the general election. The top two vote getters in some of the most important districts Democrats are looking at to win in November may end up with two Republicans in November. Shut Democrats out completely. That would be a very big blow to Democrats' chances of taking the House.
That'd California be an unintended will be one to watch.
That's what we call to watch that. For sure. I want to talk about something else that could be making headlines later this week, if not later this week, certainly in the weeks and months to come, and that is immigration. The president was tweeting about it over the weekend. He tweeted this, quote, put pressure on the Democrats to end the horrible law that separates children from their parents once they cross the border into the U.S. He went on to talk about catch and release, lottery and chain migration, and, of course, building the wall, which has been a signature promise of his as well. But this issue of separating families at the border, Amy, walk me through a little bit, because this left a lot of people scratching their heads. What does that have to do with the Democrats?
Right. Well, and in that tweet together, it also conflated two issues, I think, which is reporting that had come out recently about unaccompanied minors, children who'd come by themselves into the country, and about 1,500 of them were not located, right? Of the 5,000 or so that were put either into foster care or given to family members, they couldn't locate 1,500 of those. That is different from this conversation that the president tweeted about separating families. This is actually a Trump administration policy specifically outlined by the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, at the beginning of May. He's quoted as saying, if you don't want your child separated from you, then don't bring them across the border illegally. And other members of the administration saying that this program of taking families and, you know, putting the children, unaccompanied children in a different place from their parents was done as something of a deterrent, as a way to say to potential border crossers. Don't do it. This is the consequence of that action.
Let's get a little bit more on this from someone who covers immigration specifically. Cindy Carcamo joins us from the Los Angeles Times. I want to ask you now, this obviously a lot of attention being paid to these two stories, these immigration stories over the weekend continuing into today. One, the family separation issue at the border, and secondly, this issue of up to 1,500 lost or missing children. Can you help us shed some light on those two stories and what we know to be true?
Yes, well, I think we have to kind of take a step back in regards to why it is that we're at this point now. In regards to the new policy by the Trump administration, for a long time, it's been a misdemeanor to cross the border illegally. But now what they're doing is they're actually prosecuting or referring for prosecution a lot of these people who are crossing illegally or who are asking for asylum at a non-port of entry. So essentially what's happening is while these people are being, like the parents are being referred for criminal prosecution, the children are being placed in separate housing. And beforehand, that really wasn't happening as much. There were incidents of that, but this is going to be an ongoing policy for the Trump administration. So I think that that's what we're talking about in regards to separation of families, and that's what a lot of people are up in arms about. But I think we have to remember that there's always been this law in the books, and simply what the Trump administration is doing is they're enforcing this law. In regards to conflating these two things, in regards to the unaccompanied minors that came in 2014 and so forth, you're seeing on social media a lot of these pictures of children in these cage-like conditions. Actually, a lot of those photos are from 2014, taken during the Obama administration, when children were coming unaccompanied. And there were so many of them that they didn't know where to house them. So actually, I did a tour of one facility in Nogales, Arizona, where there were all these children sleeping on mats in this warehouse kind of facility, and they were caged. So I think, you know, we have to understand that even though we're under a different administration, you did have similar policies beforehand, not the complete separation of families like the Trump administration is doing now, but you did have families in family detention. You had children who were in detention. So I think we do have to remember that you had a similar situation happening beforehand. Maybe it wasn't like policy, but it was happening in some instances where people were separated along the border, and also families who were kept together, but they were kept in detention. Actually, the Obama administration brought back family detention. So I think we have to keep that in mind.
Cindy Carcamo from the Los Angeles Times, thanks for joining us here in studio. Susan Page and Amy Walter, thanks for being here.
You're welcome.
Stay with us. Coming up on the News Hour, a Canadian experiment that guarantees a basic income. From the News Hour bookshelf, The Soul of America, how Americans survive in the time of turmoil. An Iraq War veteran asks us all to reflect on the real meaning of Memorial Day and the powerful symbolism behind an incredible display of red poppies. On this holiday, individual stories of service and sacrifice often get lost in the headlines. Tonight, Judy Woodruff reports on a memorial dedicated to the 3 million women who've worn the uniform on behalf of the United States.
Thank you.
This gathering of military women is not the kind of event that captures much attention each year, when members of the Congressional Caucus for Women's Issues gather to pay tribute to outstanding soldiers, Marines, airmen, and sailors at the Women in Military Service for America Memorial at the entrance to Arlington National Cemetery outside Washington. And each year comes a refrain that more should be done to commemorate their contributions. Newly nominated Secretary of Veterans Affairs Robert Wilkie.
Unless we know the story and the sacrifices of our women in uniform, we cannot understand the sacrifices made to make this a more perfect union.
So it's her mom. Duh.
That's my grandma.
To really know those stories, the Women's Memorial is trying to register every woman who has served in the U.S. Armed Forces. So far, their count is 265,000, or only about 10%. Women are the fastest growing group of veterans. They have served in a variety of roles, dating back to the American Revolution. And as of 2015, are cleared for all combat roles. Women vets or their family members have to opt into the register. There is no automatic government database that the private memorial can access. Major General D. Ann McWilliams, president of the Women's Memorial Foundation, says the more names, photos, and stories gathered at the 21-year-old memorial, the richer the overall story of women's military service.
This is the only memorial to women in the world. This is a place where the story of those women can be told, can be shown to the public.
She told the story of one son who found his mother's entry and only wished he had made the effort sooner.
He came into the memorial, pulled his mother up, and there was his picture. He had never seen his mother in uniform, and he got on FaceTime and showed his mother that she was registered and then took her on a tour of the memorial. And when I met up with him, he was crying because he never brought his mom here.
The register is housed in the memorial's education center that showcases more than 240 years of American women's service with the military. From the cane of Dr. Mary Walker, the only woman in history to receive the Medal of Honor, to the World War I dog tags and victory medal belonging to Helene Coxhead, who joined the Navy at 18 and said those were the best years of her life, to a display on women POWs in World War II, and a photographic accounting of the growing and varied roles women played during the Vietnam War. There's a special exhibit honoring Jessica Ann Ellis, a combat medic in the Army who died at age 24 when an IED blew up her vehicle in Baghdad 10 years ago this month. She earned a Bronze Star and Purple Heart as part of Operation Iraqi Freedom. And amidst the memorabilia, visitors can see close to 7,000 yellow ribbons suspended from the ceiling, honoring every fallen service member killed in theater since September 11th. 88-year-old retired Brigadier General Wilma Vaught, who joined the Air Force in the 1950s, was one of the earliest women to make the rank of general officer. She was also the first woman to deploy with an Air Force bomber unit. General Vaught was the driving force behind the memorial.
Sometimes service in the military takes all you can give. All you can give mentally, all you can give physically.
Chief Master Sergeant Lisa Arnold agrees.
A young woman needs to understand that she can be very successful because of the women who have come before her.
She is truly a Renaissance woman and a great leader.
She oversees development of long-range strategic plans affecting over 250,000 service members and was the first woman to be a command chief in Afghanistan, leading over 2,000 Air Force men and women in the war. Paying it forward is part of her mission.
I look at it as moving the next roadblock out of the way so the young lady behind me doesn't have to do that. I feel like I carry a proverbial shovel with me because the path has been dug, but I dig a little bit deeper and a little bit further for the next person that wants to join our service. You know, and it doesn't matter what service, we're all sisters in arms.
Another sister with a shovel is Sergeant Major Crystal Reams of the U.S. Army, who was honored along with Arnold. Reams has performed a variety of roles, from aiding humanitarian efforts for Cuban refugees to serving as a vocalist in the U.S. Army band. Now she's a role model to daughter Aria, who wants to be a military lawyer and attends college on an ROTC scholarship.
The stories send the signal. I think it's interesting to look back and see who's done what. You know, it would be interesting for my daughter, for example, to be able to look up and you know, that's my mom or my granddaughter or my great-granddaughter or, you know, it's important for those stories to be told and to be held somewhere.
It's constantly seeing my mom readily like go to work and put like selfless commitment just to the country. That's something I would love to do too. Like I would like to be like my mom.
And as women serve in greater numbers, there are reminders of the ultimate sacrifice, of course, such as Major Marie Rossi, the first woman in military history to serve in combat as an aviation unit commander during the first Persian Gulf War. She was killed in the line of duty when her aircraft crashed. 1.9 million of the nation's 20 million veterans are now women. The memorial organizers say it is important to acknowledge their stories in life and commemorate them in death.
The economy may be doing well by many measures, but for years, there have been real concerns over wage growth and the overall standard of living. So perhaps it's not surprising that at least one recent survey showed growing public support for a new government program that would guarantee some income to citizens. There are small pilot projects of how it could work. In this Reprise report, our own economics correspondent Paul Solomon travels to Canada to see one of the larger programs for our ongoing series, Chasing the Dream, on poverty and opportunity.
Cheerios sans gluten, without gluten.
I may not speak French, but I've been in a bilingual country my entire life, so I know what the French actually...
sans gluten means.
Yep.
A Tuesday trudge to the local grocery store in Hamilton, Ontario.
Love the organic vegetables.
This is the first time 29-year-old Alana Balzer has been able to afford the healthy food here at the Mustard Seed Co-op. Because, she says, when you're poor...
It's buy the stuff that you can afford, which is generally quick, easy, and all processed and high in sugar and trans fats and all the other unhealthy stuff.
That's all that Balzer could afford on her $575 a month welfare disability check. But Ontario will now give her $1,130 a month, U.S., no questions asked, as part of a three-year basic income pilot launched late last year.
Around the world, people believe that basic income could provide simpler and more effective income support.
The idea is also being piloted in Finland and California. Now it's Ontario, too.
How are people's lives changed, and how are they able to do better in their lives, prevent illness, stay in school, get jobs, and keep jobs?
Ontario Premier Kathleen Wynne.
We should be looking at different ways of providing support, ways that actually don't punish people, but actually support people in getting on with their lives and produce better outcomes.
4,000 randomly selected Ontarians in three communities will get about $13,000 a year, U.S., for a single person, $19,000 for a couple. In exchange, recipients give up some social supports, and the government gets back 50 cents of every dollar they earn.
It is definitely the biggest basic income study that there's ever been in North America. You don't have to show that you're sick. You don't have to show that you can't work. You get it as a right.
Research director Kwame McKenzie and his team will analyze the results.
We're going to see whether it increases your chance of coming out of poverty. We're trying to see whether it makes your housing stable. We're trying to see whether it improves your mental health, whether it basically decreases your use of other services such as hospital beds.
Turns out Manitoba launched a basic income experiment in 1974 that the provincial government there later pulled the plug on.
It was an incomplete study.
But long after, researchers studying the data found...
We've got less health service use, we've got mental health improving, we've got people going back to college and getting better skills to move forward. You know, this is a great thing, right?
But was it a fluke? And could the same policy produce like results 40 plus years later? Well, for Jody Dean and family, the answer seems to be yes.
Okay, what else?
Have a nice day. See you tomorrow.
10-year-old daughter Madison has suffered from both brittle bone disease and epilepsy since toddlerhood.
How was your day?
It was okay.
Yes, Canada has universal health care, but not for the ER commute.
As far as parking goes, we're not covered for that. That's $25 an emergency visit.
How many times has she broken bones?
Well, she's probably had at least 70 breaks.
How many times a month do you have to pay for parking?
2 to 3 times a week.
Basic income now covers, in effect, half the parking bill. A huge relief for someone who never dreamed she'd be poor, used to volunteer at the food bank, then found she couldn't live without it.
How do you go back to where you just gave that time and tell them now you're in need?
Jody Dean, like Alana Baltzer, lives in Hamilton, a once thriving steel city of 750,000 within an hour of Toronto.
We used to have 40,000 people working directly in steel, and today it's probably closer to 7,000.
Tom Cooper, who directs an anti-poverty project, claims he's already seen benefits from the program.
Many of the individuals I've talked to who are on the basic income pilot are going back to school wanting to improve their opportunities to get a better job.
Moreover, he says,
there's not the oversight we see in traditional social assistance systems that requires people to report monthly on their income or their housing status or their relationship status.
While most poor Ontarians didn't make it into the pilot, Baltzer did, and no longer has to deal with the provincial welfare system.
You do not have the bureaucracy involved with welfare or disability. So if you get a job, you simply call, let them know, give them the information, submit your pay stubs, bada boom, bada bang, done.
And your mom made it onto the program. Has it made a difference in her life?
Oh God, yeah. She's more ecstatic about not having to deal with Ontario Works, the welfare workers.
The pilot has even induced Baltzer to lose 5 pounds since November. More exercise, more confidence.
It's the first time in years I've been able to wear high heels without groaning in absolute pain and sheer agony.
As for the depression she's long struggled to fend off.
It's nice to, you know, not have a full-blown episode because I'm worried about whether or not I'm going to be able to eat tonight or be able to pay my rent or do something as simple as laundry.
Other pluses? Well, from the government's point of view, it no longer has to subsidize Baltzer's housing. So the pilot's costing Ontario less than $700 a month more.
It's important to measure that and measure sort of use of government services.
But if Baltzer attends college in the fall, as now planned, and then gets a job, government would be off the hook entirely.
But it's also important to measure whether people are actually generating wealth. Because everybody thinking often about the cost, but people don't always think about the possible economic benefits.
But look, say skeptics, basic income will cost a pretty, albeit Canadian, penny going out, while benefits may never actually flow in.
I don't think the savings are actually going to be there. So I think that's misleading.
That's local lawyer David Wakely, who says if the program is extended universally, it would cost Ontario 2/3 of its annual revenue. And he doubts recipients will go to school or get a job.
Where someone can stay home and get a basic income guarantee. This just serves as a security blanket for them because they've always got this income to rely on.
And as I asked former U.S. union leader Andy Stern, isn't that the time-honored objection to a basic income?
If you pay people to do nothing, isn't that an incentive for them to continue to do nothing?
There are always people going to stay at home and take advantage of government programs. There are a lot of wealthy people and children who are paid to do nothing, and it doesn't seem to affect them being vital and involved in society.
John Clark of the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty doesn't worry about poor people taking advantage of the basic income, but he does worry that the program is a move to take advantage of them. By laying the groundwork for the elimination of government-provided social workers, health care, the eventual privatization of social services.
So you're shopping for health care, you're shopping for housing, you're shopping for public transportation, childcare, all these things. And this is the prevailing agenda at the moment, and a basic income system takes us in that direction.
Moreover, says Clark, a basic income creates downward wage pressure on the working poor.
If you create a situation where low-wage workers are receiving a significant portion of their wages out of the tax revenues, then the pressure on employers to increase wages is reduced, the pressure on governments to increase minimum wages is reduced.
So how to know then if the costs outweigh the benefits?
We can have all of these theoretical discussions, or we can say, let's do a test and see what actually happens. What are the costs? Is it a more efficient way of giving people who need it support? What are the benefits? Does it grow the economy or not? And then we can have a rational discussion based on evidence rather than just based on theory.
And rather than based on promises of breaking the cycle of poverty, which might or might not in the end be mainly smoke and mirrors. For the PBS NewsHour, this is economics correspondent Paul Salmon reporting, mainly from Ontario.
Tomorrow on the NewsHour, more in our Chasing the Dream series, with a report on helping people remain stable after they start work and begin to earn incomes again. On this Memorial Day, Judy Woodruff is back with the latest from the NewsHour bookshelf.
Pulitzer Prize-winning author John Meacham is best known for his presidential biographies of Andrew Jackson, Thomas Jefferson, and most recently George Herbert Walker Bush. Last month, Meacham delivered a eulogy during the funeral service for former First Lady Barbara Bush. The Soul of America, The Battle for Our Better Angels, is Meacham's latest book. And John Meacham, welcome back to the NewsHour.
Thank you
for being here.
Thank you.
So you write that the idea for this came when you had a colleague call you up after the terrible events in Charlottesville, Virginia last summer. A woman died in that white nationalist rally.
Right.
How did this get from that to the book?
Well, it kept rattling around in my head that we have been here before. American history, we tend to think of in nostalgic terms, and nostalgia is a powerful narcotic. But in a way, it does a disservice to the past. It suggests that somehow or another, the struggles of the past were not as pitched or as contentious as our own. And what we've done again and again in American history is run it very close to try to get things right. But we've always managed to get to higher ground. And what I wanted to try to figure out is, to what extent is this period we're in now, which feels dispiriting and depressing no matter where you stand on the political spectrum, people are unhappy. How does this compare to moments in the past where division seemed to be the rule, not the exception?
Did you find true parallels then?
Well, Mark Twain is supposed to have said that history may not repeat itself, but it does rhyme. history should not be cultural Zoloft, but it can give us perspective. It can give us a sense of proportion. At what point should we light our hair on fire? At what point should, just to pick an example at random, should a given tweet really upset us? And trying to create that sense of proportion by putting this moment in context with Andrew Johnson, a president during Reconstruction who issued a state paper saying that African Americans were genetically incapable of self-government, or Joe McCarthy, who chased after innocent people using the media of the day to create this hysterical feeling. These were moments that were incredibly difficult, and yet we now have a country, even now for all our problems, that by and large we can be proud of.
So it would take us inside one of those moments. I mean, the Ku Klux Klan rising in the 1920s and 30s. How did the country grapple with that, and how did it get through it?
Well, there are parallels, because there was a great deal of immigrant anxiety about immigrants. There was a great deal of anxiety about global affairs, because we've come out of the First World War. And a middle class, working class, white movement refounded the Ku Klux Klan. Members of Congress, there were senators, there were governors who were explicitly members of the Klan. How do we get through it? One thing is Calvin Coolidge limited immigration, so it took some of the oxygen out of the fire. But also a free press said, this is not who we are. Harding and Coolidge said, this is not who we are. And ultimately, our better angels prevailed, at least briefly.
You also write, I mean, there's so many other examples, but one of the principal ones is the Red Scare after World War II, the 1950s, the McCarthy era. And Roy Cohn was a figure, someone who coincidentally was a mentor to Donald Trump.
We hope it's coincidental. I think in many ways the early 1930s and the early 1950s are the most analogous periods. The early 1930s, we had a real question about whether democratic capitalism would survive the decade. President Roosevelt could have assumed the powers of a dictator if he had been so inclined. In the early 1950s, Joe McCarthy gives a speech in February of 1950 at Wheeling, West Virginia, saying, "I have in my hand the names of 205 communists." He didn't tweet it, but he might as well have. And it lasted about 4 years. And what happened was he understood the media. He understood how wire services worked. He understood radio. He understood television. He understood how to control the narrative. Any of this sound familiar?
Yeah.
But what happened? The people in Congress stood up. Margaret Chase Smith, Republican of Maine, was one of the first. They ended up censuring him, and they ended up arguing that America is most herself when we widen the definition of what we mean by equality, not when we narrow it.
One of the questions one comes away with is, can it really be compared to today when you've got this explosion of social media, Twitter, Facebook, and all the rest of it, just this nonstop environment of news and conflict?
Well, but if you imagine if you lived in a pre-print universe, having a newspaper come every week or every month seems like a suddenly crowded arena. Imagine the 1920s when radio suddenly nationalizes the culture. Imagine the early 1950s when television explodes. I think it's somewhat self-referential and self-defeating for us to think that this is the worst time ever. Just because something's happened before doesn't mean it's not happening now. But we can't, I think, suggest that our problems are insuperable, because they're not unique. There has always been this struggle in what I call the American soul. People say, oh, the soul of the country is X. Actually, no. In Hebrew and in Greek, it means life or breath. So in the American soul, we have room for Dr. King, but we also have room for the Klan. And every era is defined by which side of that dichotomy wins out for a given period of time.
I mean, everyone would agree the country is deeply divided right now, no matter which side you're on. But there are a lot of people who believe this president, this presidency, is exactly what they wanted.
Their cares and concerns cannot be dismissed. I wrote this book not because American presidents in the past have always risen to the occasion, but because the incumbent rises to it so seldom. And I do think there are lessons to be learned here. I wish the president and those who serve him would realize that posterity rewards the presidents who reach beyond their base, who try to unify the country and not simply cater to a given audience and a given predisposed set of supporters.
And finally, how much does it matter that this is a president who I think many of the people around him say has not paid that much attention to American history?
Oh, I think he's paid almost none. I had one conversation with him, and it was like pulling teeth, except pulling teeth might have been more fun. All I can say is that he's living in a house where there are portraits of people. Someday his portrait will hang there. And what I would hope he would do is, as he walks down those hallways, if he looks up from his phone, he would realize that he will want to be seen in a warmer and better light than he is right now. And, you know, as Winston Churchill once said, the future's unknowable, but the past should give us hope. So I think we have to hold on to that hope.
John Meacham with another book. This one is The Soul of America, The Battle for Our Better Angels. Thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
Kevin Powers signed up for the Army before finishing high school and went to basic training the day after he graduated. He was in Iraq for a year, and when he returned home, he managed to capture some of what that experience was like in his critically praised novel, The Yellow Birds. Powers says it's hard to record what you're truly thinking and feeling in combat because in many ways, you aren't doing either. Much of the fighting happens on instinct and adrenaline. That's the situation so many Americans still face, and in Power's humble opinion, what we need to remember tonight.
If you're watching this today, perhaps you're taking a break from a family barbecue, or maybe you've just returned from shopping for some much-needed item that this weekend's sales have allowed you to purchase. I hope the extra time with your loved ones is rewarding, and a long weekend, satisfying break from the challenges of work or school or parenting. But I humbly ask you to consider the following. 14 years ago, I spent Memorial Day looking for IEDs in and around the city of Mosul, Iraq. I had only been in country for a couple of months. My unit had not yet suffered its first casualty. But as summer began, the purple fingers of Iraqi citizens casting their votes felt like a cause worth facing that danger for. But soon enough, something shifted. Attacks increased in both intensity and frequency over the summer. And by the time autumn came around, several members of my company had been wounded, some seriously, and some terrifyingly so, especially when you knew you had to go back outside the wire again the next day. I'll admit, I was scared pretty much all of the time, but I did my job to the best of my ability, and I still believed that we might all make it home together. But that's not how war goes. Close to Christmas, as 2004 was coming to a close, our unit lost two young men. Their names were Sergeants Nicholas Mason and David Ruren. They were both 20 years old. I grieved for them and their families then, and I still grieve for them today. And I would ask you to consider the fact that since our current wars began in 2001, as of mid-May, there have been 6,957 others to grieve for. Just a month ago, a young man from Colorado was killed in Afghanistan. It's hard to believe that when I came home from Iraq in 2005, he was 9 years old. So today, I'd ask you to take a moment to ask how many more names might be added to the long list of those we will be asked to remember next year, and to also remember the thousands of veterans, actively serving men and women, and grieving families, their fallen brothers and sisters, for whom Memorial Day doesn't just fall on the last Monday in May, but on every single day of the rest of their lives.
And now to our NewsHour shares. Something on this Memorial Day we want you to know. The Poppy Memorial arrived on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. this weekend, commemorating all the American service members who've died since World War I.
It's 133 feet long, containing 645,000 poppies, each representing an American serviceman or woman killed in combat since World War I. In World War I, a Canadian officer visiting a comrade who he had lost in a gravesite saw poppies growing up among the crosses. He penned a poem in Flanders Field. 3 years later, an American woman, Mona Michael, wrote her own poem, We Shall Keep the Faith. And in that, she said, we should never forget the fallen. And she recommended wearing a poppy, as I'm doing. So from that day forward, the poppy has been the symbol of the fallen. The memorial is located here in an ideal location on the mall, surrounded by the Vietnam Memorial, the Korean Memorial, the Lincoln, the World War II Memorial, so that Americans can see the connection between those memorials and 645,000 lives lost. When you think about our history and you think that World War I was the war to end all wars, and we've had World War II, Korea, Vietnam, and our men and women in service are in combat right now, I think that has a lot of significance on both sides, the tragedy as well as the inspiration that they're willing to fight for their country and, if necessary, die. We need to stop and think about what Memorial Day means as Americans, the men and women that made the ultimate sacrifice so that we could be free.
On the NewsHour online right now, two women veterans who are poets share how writing has helped them heal from PTSD. Read their poems and more on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us again here tomorrow evening. We'll leave you now with the sounds and images from this Memorial Day as we continue to remember and honor those who've given their lives in service to this country. For all of us here at the PBS NewsHour, thank you and good night.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, financial services firm Raymond James, Leidos, and by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, supporting science, technology, and improved economic performance and financial literacy in the 21st century. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.